Good evening, everybody, and a very warm welcome to all of you. My name is Alex Bakawi. I'm the director of CEP. And I'd like to start off with a huge thank you to all of you for joining us tonight. Because as many of you will know, our work at CEP is very much driven by the conviction that economic debates too often take place in there are some places also in the first row. We need to fill up that first row as well. David, Stephanie, come on. Economic debates too often take place in very narrow circles, and also our conversations on economic policies rarely get the joint scrutiny from different perspectives that we would hope for. And it's thus just a huge delight to see you here and to see the diversity that you bring into this room, ranging from the vantage points of central banks, commercial banks, business, investors, over to NGOs, policymakers, media, and academia. So thank you very much. Another big thank you obviously goes to our speaker, Adair Turner. Lord Turner, it's an absolute pleasure and honor to have you here. I leave the challenging task of an introduction that does justice to your vita to Martin Cihak from the IMF, but let me nonetheless emphasize how much we appreciate and are inspired by your work to advance economic thinking, including obviously also the debates that you engage in. And on that note, I want to mention one particular debate that you've engaged in with our advisor, Bill White, a while ago on monetary financing. And on that note, Bill, I don't see you at the moment, but it's lovely to have you back here in Zurich. Thank you very much. Finally, I would also like to thank the IMF for not only co-hosting this event with us tonight, but also a two-day workshop that we started this morning to zoom in on the specific topic of monetary policy, macroprudential regulation, and inequality. And it's fantastic to have you guys here, and a delight that I, in a minute, can turn over to Martin Cihak, who's an advisor in the Monetary and Capital Markets Department at the IMF, and who'll say a couple of words on behalf of the fund and then introduce our speaker. Before I do that, let me just remind you that this meeting is on the record, and that we would appreciate it if you haven't done so already, if you could put your cell phones on silent or off. Thank you very much. Martin, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Alex. Ladies and gentlemen, Lord Turner. It's a great pleasure to be co-hosting this event with CEP. We think it's extremely timely. We are just gearing up for our annual meetings later this week in Washington. And some of these themes that you will hear about today are very much central to our discussions in Washington. So you know, I personally am looking forward to hearing the remarks. Lord Turner needs really no introductions. Most of you know him very well from the public sphere. Let me just highlight some of his work in the public sphere and academia. So, of course, he's been the chairperson of the UK Financial Services Authority from the 2008 to 2013. And he also chaired the all-important Standing Committee on Supervisory and Regulatory cooperation at the FSB, at the Financial Stability Council, in Basel. And in those roles, he played a major role in reshaping financial regulation in response to the crisis. And he also holds a number of visiting professorships and other appointments. But let me just say that his talk today, as I understand, is based on a book that is about between being debt, between debt and devil. And I think it's an important topic. It probably doesn't say many good things about debt. And I'm looking forward to hearing. I think we also, we wanna hear how the new how the new system will look like, how the new more equity and more equity-based and more equitable financial system would look like, and that's what we are looking forward to hearing in this talk. Lastly, Lord Adair is the chairman of the Institute for New Economic Thinking. So that's something that we will see and hear today, what this new economic thinking and hopefully better economic thinking is about. So without further ado, Lord Turner, the podium is yours. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, and it's a great pleasure to be here with an extremely interesting group of people drawn from a number of institutions and all involved in these issues. I've entitled what I'm going to say Global Finance, Debt, and Sustainability. And what I've tried to do in this lecture is to link some of the themes of this book, which came out last year, Between Debt and the Devil, with some wider themes which were in the first draft of that but then got taken out. And they got taken out for good reason, because my publisher said, focus it. Don't try and say too much. Because the book is about the role of debt in the process of economic growth. But I then had a chapter in the original draft that says, well, but why are we interested in economic growth at all? Is economic growth the objective? And as I say, I took that out for simplicity's sake, but I put it back in today. And I put back in some thoughts that I actually had, which I set out in another book called Economics After the Crisis, which were based upon the Lionel Robbins memorial lectures that I gave at the LSE 5 years ago. So I'm attempting today to give a still more comprehensive point of view of the role of debt in the economies, even than is in this book. I think that the role of debt is fundamental to the operations of modern economies for the last many decades, but is not well dealt with in most modern macroeconomic theory. If I had to set out one chart which sums up not just why the crisis of 2008 occurred, but why the aftermath of it has been so difficult to deal with, why 8 years after it we're still struggling with low growth and low inflation, that one chart would be this, which I actually take from Reinhardt and Rogoff, not from their book, but from an article that came out at the end of 2013. And what it shows is private domestic credit as a percent of GDP, non-financial, we're not dealing with the leverage of the financial system here, nor are we dealing with governments, we're dealing with household and non-financial corporate debt, for all the advanced economies together from 1950 to 2011. And as you can see, that went from about 50% in 1950 to reach 170% by 2007, and it grew at pretty much every year from 1950 to 2007, and at an accelerating pace after 1950. What I think is interesting about this growth of debt was that at the time, it rang very few alarm bells. Now, I'm going to make an exception for that, because actually we have in the audience today one of the alarm bells that did ring, and that alarm bell was called Bill White, then at the BIS. But on the whole, the vast majority of the economics profession did not consider that this growth of debt was concerning. Indeed, I would go further than that. there was a very significant body of economic thought which was almost entirely concentrated on the issue of too little debt in our economies rather than too much. There is within economics and within economic history quite a rich literature about why we have debt contracts as well as equity contracts. There is a theoretical literature which starts from the question, well, why can't we run our economies in an entirely equity fashion? Why can't all investments take the form of you take your money and you invest it in this entrepreneur's project and you get a return from the profit, or from the profit coming out of that? And there is a theory, particularly associated with the economist Robert Townsend, called costly state verification, which says, well, one of the reasons why you can't run an economy on that basis is it's very difficult to know when you make an equity contract whether the entrepreneur is treating you fairly or is cooking the books and skimming off the money, and therefore you like to have debt contracts whereby the money comes back to you, whatever the profitability. And there's another body of theory that says there's a whole load of investors who will not invest unless they have the apparent certainty of a debt contract as against an equity contract. And there is a body of economic history that argues that we simply would not have had the developments of the Industrial Revolution if we had tried to organize that in an entirely all-equity fashion, that we needed the emergence of debt contracts as well as equity contracts, and indeed that we needed the emergence of banks in order to lubricate those debt contracts. And Walter Badgett in Lombard Street argued that, for instance, the British Industrial Revolution and the faster pace of that compared with the French development at that time had a lot to do with the greater development of a financial sector and a banking sector at that time. So there's a lot in the literature about why we need debt contracts as well as equity, why we need banks, and on the whole, what that literature tends to tell you is that the more of this finance you have, the better. So that if you look at, for instance, a meta-review of the literature, Ross Levine's Finance and Growth, Theory and Evidence, in the Handbook of Economic Growth 2005, he says there's a growing body of empirical analysis which demonstrates a strong positive link between the functioning of the financial system and long-run economic growth. Better developed financing systems ease external financial constraints facing firms. And then he arrays empirical econometric analysis that says there is a positive correlation between growth and a number of ratios, such as the liabilities of the financial system as a percent of GDP, bank credit to private enterprise as a percent of GDP, turnover of equity markets to market capitalization. And most of the literature fundamentally said the more developed your financial system, the better for growth. And insofar as there were concerns expressed, they were concerns about countries that had underdeveloped financial systems. There was a lot in the literature that said, look at India. India in 1980 only had debt to GDP of 10%. Our econometrics tells us that if only their debt to GDP was 30 or 40 or 50%, they would have grown faster than at 10%. And there was extraordinarily little in the literature which suggested that there might be a possibility of having too much debt and too large a financial system rather than too little. Now, I think that tendency to think that more debt would always be good, and that, for instance, bank credit to private enterprises as a percent of GDP was, as it were, a linear and limitless positive correlation, I think that might have been a legitimate thing, or at least would be more likely to be a legitimate thing to say, if two things that our economic textbooks say about banks and credit were true. If you pick up an undergraduate textbook, or even many advanced papers which set out theories of how the financial system is working. What you will tend to find is that when they describe banks, if they describe banks at all, and actually a lot of modern undergraduate textbooks rather exclude the banking system, but to the extent that they do describe it, it will tend to say two things. First, that banks take deposits of money from savers, who are often described as being the household sector, and they lend money to borrowers. And secondly, to an extraordinary extent, what they say is banks lend money to entrepreneurs and businesses, thus allocating funds between alternative investment projects. And then there's often a lot of discussion in the literature as to whether banks achieve that allocation of credit between alternative capital investment projects better or less well than equity market allocations. There's a lot of literature on that. My problem with these statements is that as I thought more and more about the banking and credit creation system, I ended up believing that these two statements really belong on the same shelves of the bookshelf as Harry Potter. As descriptions of what banks do in the modern economy, I think these are essentially fictional statements. I think they're fictional for two reasons. First, because the statement banks take deposits of money from savers and lend it to borrowers fails to understand what Knut Wicksell understood and describes in Interest and Prices back in 1904, the fact that banks don't take pre-existing money and lend it on, they create credit, money, and purchasing power which did not previously exist. And I think one of our immense problems with modern macroeconomics is that that insight, which was fundamental to Wicksell, fundamental to a lot of Hayek, present in Keynes, more in a sense within the treatise on money than in the general theory, but present in Keynes, fundamental to Minsky, really in mainstream economics disappears from the literature from about 1960s onwards, as indeed courses on banking and credit often disappear from the undergraduate curriculum. Banks create credit, money, and purchasing power. And it therefore matters hugely to whom they allocate the credit and purchasing power that they create. And here, the second of these statements, that banks lend money to entrepreneurs and businesses, is again largely fictional. Because if you actually look empirically at what banks do in modern economies, lending it to actual new capital investment is actually a minority part of what they do. The great empirical study which has illustrated this is by Alan Taylor, Oscar Yorda, and Maurice Schullerich, called The Great Mortgaging. And they have tracked what the banks of advanced economies have done way back to 1870. And in particular, they focused on how much of what banks do is lending against real estate. Now, the ratio is incredibly volatile in the early 20th century. Broadly speaking, if you have great wars and hyperinflations, some weird and volatile things happen to bank balance sheets. But broadly speaking, the big picture is that from 1870 through to about 1950 or so, banks lend about 30-35% of their balance sheets to fund real estate. But that from the 1950s onwards, that just relentlessly increases. It is now in almost all banking systems, or in the US, in the capital market system, the securitized credit system, over 60%. And indeed, these figures underestimate it, because the way that these researchers can track it is to look at lending which takes the specific form of a mortgage against real estate, but there is also some lending effectively against real estate which doesn't take a specific legal mortgage charge form. And the way that they sum up what they are saying is that with very few exceptions, the bank's primary business did indeed consist of mortgage lending to companies in as late as 1928, in as late as 1970. But by 2007, banks in most countries had turned primarily into real estate lenders. The intermediation of household savings for productive investment in the business sector which, as they stress, is the standard textbook role of the financial sector, constitutes only a minor share of the business of banking today. Now, this is quite a problem. If we are bringing up entire new generations of economists with textbooks, which have a textbook description of what banks do, which is only a minority bit of what banks do, we are not equipping ourselves well to understand how the real economy works. At very least, we ought to change the textbooks and bring them in line with reality. But we also need to understand that if the vast majority of lending is against real estate, that has a very specific implication. Some of that lending against real estate is lending against the construction of new real estate. And that is a process which can run out of control in a way that Hayek actually very well described, in which irrational expectations of returns from capital investments end up producing houses in the middle of the Irish countryside, which will never be occupied, or airports in the middle of the Spanish countryside, which will never have a plane landing at them. And I can tell you that is occurring on a massive scale in China today, where I think there is a huge number of apartment blocks being built on the basis of credit and third and fourth tier cities, which I think will never have a single person go and live in with them. But in a sense, perhaps even more important is that the vast majority of this lending against real estate in rich developed countries isn't even funding new constructive investment of any sort. It is essentially funding the purchase of real estate assets that already exist. In reasonably densely populated cities of rich countries, there is an extraordinary tendency for real estate to be locationally specific. People want to live, or companies want to locate, in very specific locations. And an enormous amount of all credit is essentially devoted to financing a competition between people for the ownership of assets that already exist. And if I may just say as an aside there, I think the analysis of assets that already exist, and in particular locational land, is again something which was in economics as it originally developed in the 19th century. It is fundamental to Ricardo's economics, where there is a three-factor model of land and capital and labor, and has largely disappeared from modern economics with its two-factor model of capital, which is assumed always to be newly created capital, where the capital stock is the accumulation of previous year's capital investment. There is a huge importance within modern economies of locationally specific real estate, and a huge proportion of all lending in modern economies essentially finances a purchase of locationally specific real estate, which is in inelastic supply. And if the majority of lending is lending against an asset which is in inherently inelastic supply, because you cannot rapidly create more Mayfair or more Kensington or more whatever is the nice part of Zurich, which I'm sure is the nice part that we're in at the moment, then when you extend credit, the only thing that it can give is the price. We have these extraordinary strong cycles where increased credit extended produces increased asset prices, which then produces expectations of future asset price increases, which produces low credit losses and a period of high bank profits, all of which generates both actual and apparent increases in the net worth of both borrowers and lenders, and changes in the expectations of borrowers and lenders, which then generates more borrowing and lending, and the cycle goes round and round in the fashion that Hyman Minsky discussed. And this is why, as Claudio Borio and others at the BIS have pointed out, cycles of credit and real estate price turn out to be not just part of the story of financial and macroeconomic instability in modern economies, they are again and again the whole story. They're basically what goes wrong in Scandinavia in the early 1990s. They're a large part of what goes wrong in Thailand and in Indonesia in 1994. They are what goes wrong in Japan in the 1980s, and they're what goes wrong in the parts of the US and Spain and Ireland in the run-up to 2008. Why does this matter? It matters because if we get these very strong cycles of credit and asset prices, and it is in particular real estate prices rather than anything else, and if we then have a crisis of confidence so that this runs into reverse, a spiral downwards, and if that occurs when the debt level is already very high, we enter in an environment where the debt never goes away, it simply shifts around the economy, and where all our policy levers to maintain adequate nominal demand appear to be either blocked or to be ineffective. That is what I think has occurred after 2007, and we ought to have known that it would occur because we had a canary in the mine, and the canary in the mine was Japan. Japan in the 1980s had probably one of the biggest of these cycles that the world has ever seen. Though I do just say that I think China is putting in a good competitive attempt right now to overtake Japan as the number one example of this ever occurring. But in Japan in the 1980s, we have this extraordinary credit and real estate boom. The amount of bank credit extended against real estate goes up about 3.5 times or so in 5 years. Commercial property prices go up by 4 times in 5 years. You then get, in about 1990, a crash of confidence, and it all spins down in the other direction. Commercial property prices fall by 70%, having gone up by 4 times, and you are left with a whole load of corporates which feel over-leveraged. In an attempt to deal with the fact that they are over-leveraged in the way that Richard Koo describes in what I think is a very good book, The Holy Grail of Macroeconomics, Lessons from Japan's Balance Sheet Recession, those over-leveraged corporates become focused on restoring their balance sheets, they slam down on investment, and they slam down on investment even when the Bank of Japan cuts the interest rate to zero. They become completely interest rate inelastic. In that environment, what happens is that the economy goes into a recession, tax revenues go down, and the public sector runs a large deficit. That large deficit is both naturally arising and very useful because it is a stimulus offsetting the deleveraging of the private sector, but with the inevitable consequence that the debt doesn't go away, it simply moves to the public sector as the public sector debt stock relentlessly increases. So that the big story of Japan for the last 25 years is a long, slow deleveraging of the non-financial corporate sector, with its debt to GDP coming down from 150% to 100%, offset by the fact that public debt has gone up from 50% of GDP to 250% of GDP and still rising, with total debt to GDP, private to public together, just going on up and up and up. Once you have excessive debt, it doesn't go away. It just sort of moves around like sort of water on a waterbed. You can press down one side, but the other side will go up. But it's not quite like a waterbed, because actually the water level is going up all the time. And that pattern from Japan has just been copied across the developed world since 2008. Overall, if we look at the top line here for the developed markets, and I put together two different series here, up to the end of 2013, I can use the wonderful integrated database, which is in the Geneva Report number 16, with the great title, Deleveraging, What Deleveraging, produced in 2014, which points out that if you looked then at developed market debt, corporate and public combined, it hadn't gone down after 2008, it had actually gone up, because for every bit of deleveraging by the private sector, there was a more than offsetting increase in the public sector. Over the last 2 years, It's just about flat. There's a very, very smart, slight fall. I've spliced together with it the latest BIS data there. But over the last 2 years, that very, very little bit of overall deleveraging in the developed world has been offset at the global level by an extraordinary pace of up-leveraging of the emerging market. And that isn't just a coincidence. It isn't just that the emerging markets have leveraged up by coincidence. The one has caused the other. The most important driver of the increase in leverage in the emerging markets is China. And China's increase in leverage is a direct consequence of the crisis of 2008 and of the previous increase of leverage elsewhere. Because the dynamics are that the Chinese authorities in 2009 were terrified that the crisis and attempted deleveraging by, in particular, the US household sector would drive a reduction in their export demand and produce unemployed people. To offset it, they unleashed this enormous construction boom, credit-fueled construction boom in China. A credit to GDP goes from 150% to 250% between 2009 and 2014. The investment rate, already very high at just over 40%, goes up to 48%. China pours more concrete in 4 years than America did in the whole of the 20th century. An enormous boom. And this is a direct product of attempted deleveraging in the US household sector and the fear that what that will do to demand for Chinese exports. So again, what we have across the world is a situation where once we have got too much debt, once we had created that too much debt by 2007, we are stuck in a situation where it doesn't go away. And we seem to only be able to keep our economies going with ever more debt. In this environment, it seems that all our traditional policy levers are blocked. In the immediate aftermath of the crisis, everybody agrees that what I call funded fiscal deficits, so just classic fiscal deficits, financed by the issue of debt, probably better to call it debt-financed fiscal deficits, that they're the right thing to do. So at the meeting of the G20 in London in April 2009, broad agreement, let's all run bigger fiscal deficits. And it is undoubtedly true that the immediate first-round effect of that is stimulative, and it helps offset the deleveraging in the private sector. But after a while, you then begin to worry, but what are we going to do about long-term debt sustainability in the public sector? What are we going to do about that rising Japanese debt level from 50 to 250% of GDP? And people say, well, we better have fiscal austerity to offset that. So we then get the consensus policy mix from about 2010 on, which is we've got to have fiscal consolidation, but whippy, we know how to offset that with ultra-loose monetary policy. But I think what we have now realized, and I think we should have realized earlier, that ultra-loose monetary policy is an imperfect mechanism in an environment of a very high debt trap, a debt overhang. It has adverse side effects, and it's subject to diminishing marginal returns. It's imperfect because if the transmission mechanism is through the interest rate to investment decision-making and to the consumption of the household sector, I think it is clear that at very least we have diminishing marginal returns. And after a while, and in particular, if we go through the zero bound and actually go negative, potentially actually adverse effects. In terms of just diminishing marginal returns, ask yourself this. The ECB, in attempting to stimulate the economy further, in March this year, launched a new round of QE. That managed to bring down the German 10-year bond yield by another 10 basis points, from about 20 basis points to 10. It's even lower now. I would like you to name me a single German corporate which, faced with a further reduction in the cost of funds by 10 basis points when they were already lower than they had ever previously experienced, made a single extra euro of investment. I do not think that such a corporate existed. I do not think that corporate investment is that interest rate sensitive once interest rates are already that low. So people say, oh no, that's not the transmission mechanism. The transmission mechanism is through asset prices. You drive up the price of bonds, there are then asset portfolio reallocation effects, so people go up to equities, equities go up in price. Then there's a sort of Tobin's Q effect, where the higher is the market rate to the book price of equity, the more that people rush out invest. But it's a very indirect and imperfect and unsure transmission lever through to the real economy. And the danger, indeed, is that all we're doing by these very low interest rates is that we end up encouraging all sorts of highly leveraged financial speculation long before we get through to the real economy. And by the way, we increase inequality. There's a great piece of analysis in Andy Haldane's latest speech at the end of June. It's about the UK recovery, and it's called Whose Recovery? Who has benefited from this recovery? And it has one chart that points out that over the last 8 years, UK GDP per capita has just returned to 2007 levels, and wealth in the UK has gone up 40%. Well, that's pretty much bound to occur if the lever by which you are attempting to re-stimulate the economy is through the transmission mechanism of ultra-low interest rates and asset prices, which is one of the overtly described transmission levers of ultra-loose monetary policy. So people say, no, it's not ultra-low interest rates and companies borrowing, it's not the asset price, it's the currency. But here's a simple fact. Devaluing your currency can stimulate one economy in a world economy which is doing quite well. But if the whole world economy is facing from a debt overhang problem, we cannot solve that problem by devaluing all our currencies against those of other planets. That is not an available policy response. Currency devaluation has to be a zero-sum game. All of which, and finally, insofar as ultra-loose monetary policy can re-stimulate the economy, it can only do it by re-stimulating the growth of private credit, which is what got us into this mess in the first place. So we really do seem to be stuck. We seem to be stuck with a debt overhang which faces us with an unavoidable choice. Either we're going to have sustained low growth and low inflation almost forever with debt burdens that don't decline, or we're going to have debt write-off, default, and restructuring. And some people would argue that's what we've got to do. We should just write down some of these debts. But I think it's really quite difficult to have debt write-off across the economy at a scale which is macro significant and significantly brings down debt to GDP without that itself having a disruptive effect on the economy. Or we just do debt erosion via ultra-low interest rates. We maintain forever interest rates below the rate of inflation, however low the rate of inflation is, and eventually we get out of it, but we don't, because the very process of making the existing debts affordable actually means that we lead to new debt creation. I think this is the situation we're in, and this is why The Economist in March this year had a picture of central bankers with a large gun and the question mark out of ammunition. That's why across the world there is an increasing discussion as, are we at the limits of monetary policy effectiveness? And I think the answer is we are, and we have been for several years. Now, if that is a correct analysis of the situation that we're in, that describes two fundamental problems which public policy has to solve. What to do about the situation that we're in? How do we deal with the problem that we have too much debt? And what do we have to do to stop getting into this mess in the first place? I'm going to come back later to the first of those questions. What do we do once we're in this mess? But I want to begin by saying, what should we have done not to get into this mess in the first place? And the way I sum up the dilemma which we seem to face in macroeconomic policy is this. You can think about a sort of stylized story of the developed world economies, at least certainly for the 20 years or so before the crisis, was that actually, they were achieving what looked like fairly attractive growth rates of nominal GDP. If you look across most of the advanced economies, that they tended to have nominal GDP growth rates sort of around the 4 to 5% level. And that was pretty good, and we described it as the Great Moderation, because we said that enables us to combine 2% inflation rates, which we've decided is a good rate of inflation, with about 2% growth, which we think is sort of the sort of pace that rich developed economies can grow at. And there were a lot of central banks patting themselves on the back and saying, great job, the Great Moderation. But meanwhile, at the same time, the growth rate of nominal private credit was about 10 to 15%. And at the time, it sort of seemed that we needed this 10 to 15% growth rate in order to have nominal GDP grow at about 4 or 5%. Because, at least according to our models, if you'd tried to slow down the nominal GDP growth rate with a higher interest rate, we'd have had a higher nominal GDP growth rate, and either inflation would have been below target or real output growth would have been below potential. So it seemed that we had an equilibrium which required nominal credit to grow faster than nominal GDP. But if that is true in perpetuity, if we can only grow a modern economy with a pace of growth of nominal credit which grows faster than nominal GDP, then we have a relentlessly rising leverage ratio, and eventually the system will blow up. In formal terms, indeed, we do not have an economy in equilibrium. This could be true as a transitional path, but if you believe that economies have to reach some sort of stable equilibrium, this cannot possibly be one. So a crucial question that I ask in my book is this fundamental? Is there something about modern economies which can only grow at an adequate rate of nominal GDP with a still faster rate of nominal credit? Because if that is the case, then we are just condemned to periodic instability of the sort that we're going through. And in the book, I argue that, no, that's not true, that you could imagine a modern economy which was growing in equilibrium, where the growth of nominal credit was roughly in line with nominal GDP, but that in order to achieve that equilibrium economy, we have to address three fundamental drivers of why we have such credit-intensive economies. And those three drivers are inequality, the nature of real estate within our economies, and global current account imbalances. Inequality. We know that there have been very big increases in inequality in the rich developed world. In the US, 30 years in which real wages of the bottom quarter have really not gone up at all. Top 1% has gone up, you know, three times. We also know that the marginal propensity to save of richer people is higher than the marginal propensity to save of poorer people, from which it follows that if you had a rise in inequality and you had no other offsetting action, then you would tend to have a rising attempted ex-ante savings rate. And unless that attempted rise in the ex-ante attempted savings rate, desired savings rate, was met by an increase in the ex-ante intended or desired investment rate, then you would have a problem of deficient nominal demand, which would only be solved by a fall in the equilibrium real interest rate. And I think that is part of the story of why we have such low equilibrium real interest rates, but it's also the story that part of the solution to that problem of attempted increased savings by the rich was that the savings of the better off were essentially picked up by the financial system and lent to middle and lower income people who were attempting to make up with more credit for the fact that their real wages weren't going up, in a process which Raghu Rajan in his book Fault Lines described as let them eat credit, a political situation where the only answer to rising inequality was let them eat credit. I think that is an important part of the story, and I therefore believe, and I know there's been studies of this in the IMF, that it's likely that in order to create more sustainable economies which can grow without excessive credit growth, we need to deal with the problems of inequality. I think we also have to address head-on this issue of real estate and its role in modern economies. And I think it's a hugely underexplored issue within economics. Indeed, it's largely ignored. But it's absolutely fundamental to where is wealth. This chart is taken from Thomas Piketty, Capital in the 21st Century. Of course, you've all got a copy of Thomas Piketty on your bookshelves. Some of you have even read all of the 700 pages of Thomas Piketty's book, but I have actually. This chart is taken from it. What it shows, as everybody's well familiar with, is this extraordinary cycle which Piketty describes of the ratio between capital or wealth and national income, which in the 18th and 19th centuries tended to have a ratio of 6 or 7. Then in the mid-20th century, it falls to 2 or 3. Now it is back in many developed economies to sort of 5 or 6. But what Piketty does not himself stress, though the fact is springs out immediately from the chart, because this chart is simply taken straight from Piketty, and the only thing I've added is the colors. What he does not himself stress is that the increase in that capital to income ratio is almost entirely described by one thing, which is housing. And as a fine article by Maurice Schulerich points out, of that rise of the value of housing relative to income, in most countries, 80% of that has nothing to do with the constructed value of the house. It is a rise in the value of the land on which the house sits. I happen myself to own a house in central London, and I am very lucky because it is now worth about 7 times what I paid for it in 1994. I assure you, this has very little to do with the new kitchen that I have installed or the double glazing. It is almost entirely to do with the extraordinary increase in the value of a piece of land, no bigger hardly than the bit of land here to the left of the platform. We have these extraordinary strong effects in our most successful cities, in which high-skilled, successful people and businesses cluster. We have extraordinarily strong clustering and agglomeration effects in modern economies, and those then tend to produce extraordinary increases in the land value of those economies. And we're seeing this now in Shanghai and Guangzhou and Beijing as well as in Singapore and in San Francisco and in Hong Kong, etc. This, I think, is a hugely underexplored bit of economics. I don't think it's going to go away. I think it is fundamental to the way the economy works, but it has a very particular consequence, because if there is a tendency over time for the wealth-to-income ratio in the specific form of the housing value to the income to go up, if that is a secular tendency, it is a secular tendency which is bound periodically then to be magnified by a credit effect. Because the easiest thing for a private banker to lend against, the thing that feels like the lowest risk thing to do, is to lend against real estate. And the very process of lending against real estate gives an extra twist to a process which is driven by fundamentals, which then generates a set of expectational effects, which pushes it up further. There is something fundamental about modern economies, and I call this the high-tech, high-touch paradox, that in an environment where we think that our economies are being driven by distance-less, immaterial, non-physical things like software, the biggest store of wealth which is increasing in value is the most physical thing of all, which is irreproducible land. That has a set of consequences that tends to produce an over-leveraged economy. We need to manage the consequences of that. The third factor is global imbalances. It is a simple fact that if, as today, Germany is running a current account surplus equal to 8% of GDP, unless that 8% of GDP current account surplus is fully matched by German purchases of houses in Greece or equities somewhere in the world or some category of real property, it is bound to be matched by a debt somewhere in the world. And the enormous current account balances that we have between China and the rest of the world, between Germany and other parts of Europe, Germany and the rest of the world, are bound to produce debts, many of which are unsustainable. All of which says that we are not going to solve these problems of an over-credit-intensive economy unless we address these issues of inequality, of the nature of real estate in our economy, which is not going to go away but has to be managed, and global current account balances. All of which has some implications for the theory of monetary policy and for our approach to debt. I think monetary aggregates matter a lot. I do not think that we can run monetary policy by simply focusing on the current rate of inflation. And we know we can't because actually we were remarkably successful before the crisis of achieving stability around the target rate of inflation of about 2%, but we still had the biggest financial crisis of the last three quarters of a century. But I also believe that most of the focus on monetary aggregates before the crisis was looking the wrong way. Most of the focus, for instance, the Bundesbank's argument for a second pillar with the ECB regime, believed that money, the liability side of the banking system, was a good predictive indicator of future inflation. I don't think that is the case. I think that it's credit that you have to focus on, the asset side of the banking system, and that excessive growth of credit is a good further forward indicator of crisis, debt overhang, post-crisis depression, and deflation. Monetary aggregates matter. We have ignored them. Secondly, the mix of debt matters. I haven't gone through this in detail, but we need to focus on the fact that debt is used for three really rather different things. It is used in order to finance investment, be that investment in plant and machinery or infrastructure in real estate. It is used to finance consumption, and it is used to finance a competition for the ownership of assets that already exist. And these three different forms of debt perform different functions in the economy and have very different consequences for economic stability and growth. I think I'd better be... Okay, okay. 5 to 10 minutes. I will accelerate. I also think, however, that this takes us back to the issue of what can we say about whether there is too much debt in our economies. I described earlier the assumption that between debt to GDP and growth, there was a linear and limitless positive relationship. That is the implication of what you find in that Ross Levine paper. But I think what we are increasingly seeing, for instance, from the OECD last year, is a set of data we're suggesting that beyond a certain point, as credit goes up, we get a negative effect from more credit. What we are seeing essentially is a process where if we put growth or productivity or social welfare up the left-hand axis and financial intensity either in general or in the specific form of credit to GDP along the horizontal axis, we have an inverse U relationship, a period, a spectrum across which there is a positive relationship and an area across which there is a negative relationship. I believe that most debt is not needed to drive growth and creates a debt overhang which traps us in slow growth. And I therefore think we need policies which prevent too much credit creation in the first place. But let me just add, and then I will cease after that, what if maximum growth is not the desirable objective? What if on that previous chart, growth, productivity, and social welfare are not precisely correlated? We know that we have reasons for believing that that might be the case. We know that there appear to be disconnects which have occurred within the last 30 years between measurements of happiness or welfare and GDP per capita. And I think there is a reasonable hypothesis that the ability of economic and technological process per se, as measured by GDP per capita, to drive a relentless increase in contentment or welfare may disconnect. Economic and technological progress may produce a relentless and limitless increase in GDP per capita, but beyond a certain point, human well-being may cap out. Or rather, it may be that the relationship between income and utility and happiness is quite different for different subsets of what goes on in our economy. That we have some areas of what we can use income for, like, for instance, better healthcare, where it probably is limitless. The more income we have, the better healthcare we have. In a sense, we are more contented. We have others, like branded and fashion goods, where beyond a certain level, there is simply a certain level of contentment. I think most of us are probably happier in a world where there are the possibility of fashion goods and design and style than one where there is no fashion goods and design and style. But I think it's also pretty unlikely that the process of more and more activity being created to branded fashion goods and design is going to make us any happier. The processes of competition between fashion goods, stylish goods, is simply an endless process of competition. It's an expression of individual creativity which leaves us, you know, static at a certain level of happiness, but it has no ability to drive a further increase in contentment or welfare. And therefore, I do think we need a point of view, and I think I will end on this chart, about how we should think about growth in already rich societies. And then I'll put one final chart about debt. I think beyond a certain point, growth in average per capita GDP probably has diminished potential to deliver human welfare. I think human ingenuity plus economic freedom will tend to produce a rise in productivity and thus growth. But I think that different forms of growth have different potential to increase human welfare. I therefore think that maximizing growth in already rich societies should not be the overwhelming objective, but that economic freedom is valuable in itself and will produce growth. And that public policy therefore needs to ensure that the harmful impacts of growth are minimized and the positive impacts maximized. What does that mean for debt? Well, debt is an apparently low-risk claim on future money income. I believe, however, that both the private credit creation system and the public political process can create too much debt, private debt or public debt, relative to future prospective money income, and that this can leave economies stuck in a debt overhang trap. And I think this problem is more likely to be severe if future money growth prospects are either reduced for bad reasons or reduced for the good reason that we've realized that more growth is not necessarily going to make us happier. All of which means that if maximum growth is not the objective, we should be even more wary of accumulating excessive debt. And that is where I will end for now. And maybe in questions we can deal with, what do I think we should do to stop there being excessive debt? And what on earth do I think we should do to get out of the excessive debt which we're already in. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Adair, for these very thoughtful and also stimulating remarks. It's always, it feels bad to ask someone who is so deep into these topics, can we please go over to Q&A, because I know we could have listened for much longer, but nonetheless wanted to at least take 15 to 20 minutes to get the audience comment and ask questions. I'll use the privilege of holding the mic to ask a first one that also gives you a heads up to prepare for your questions. And I'll use that, Lord Turner, to move to what I know are your next slides, which right. are the policy implications, yep. which are obviously hugely important. You've spent a lot of thoughts on the diagnosis, but I know you've also spent an equal amount of thoughts on the solutions. And I'd like to focus on one particular one, and that is where you say in your book and elsewhere, you would suggest to attach social risks to the risk weighting schemes in banking regulation rather than private risks. And yep. that is one of several examples that you give on how you do what you've mentioned on the previous slide, namely to channel debt towards those things that we like from those that we find harmful.
That was the very next slide. okay. I think we have, the way I express it in my book is that if you leave the banking system to itself, it will, through no fault of its own, because what it will do is completely rational, it will create too much of the wrong sort of debt. Left to itself, it will take the total debt level as a percent of GDP beyond the turning point of that inverse U. And it will tend to lend money to finance a competition in existing assets, and in particular, in exhaustive real estate assets. And it's not just that it seems to private bankers that that is a rational thing to do, but for them, it is a rational thing to do. I can tell you, as the director of a bank, a startup bank today, lending money unsecured to a medium-sized or small business with a business plan is a really scary thing to do. And you have to put in a lot of analysis and thinking about the business and working out what you think of the quality of the entrepreneur. And it's far easier to lend money against a piece of real estate. And provided you keep your loan to values low enough, say below 60% or so, it's highly likely that in pretty much all states of the world, you'll be okay. But there's a social externality. There is here, I think, a fundamental disconnect between that which is rational for the private banker from the point of view of their shareholders and their solvency, and that which is rational for society. Because even if, and I give you this paradox, even if every single loan piled up against real estate paid back in full, and there were no bad loan losses in one of these real estate cycles, and no banks that went bankrupt, you can still do harm to the macroeconomy. Because as Atif Mian and Amir Sufi have argued in their book, House of Debt, the fundamental problem of too much debt against real estate, which goes up in value and then down in value, derives from what happens on the real economy and the volatility that puts into consumption and investment in the real economy. And that adverse effect on the real economy can occur even if you don't have a financial crisis. Now, empirically, the worst of those effects will tend to occur when we also have a financial crisis. But I think it's very important to realize that in theory, you could have a harmful debt and asset price cycle without a single bank going bankrupt. Indeed, at the limit, without a single debt not being repaid. Because as Mian and Sufi point out, the thing that drove the slowdown of the American economy in 2009 as consumers hit the brakes is driven as much, and indeed far more, by the consumers who do pay back their debts as well by the consumers who don't pay back their debts. It's the fact that a whole load of good borrowers, right, who realize that they've got overborrowed, cut down their consumption, cut down their investment in order to survive and do survive, which drives us down into a recession in which the public debt goes up. There's a section of my book where I say good lending can be bad. What looks rational from the point of view of the private lender can be bad. And that's why within the radical change of regulation that I would introduce, what would I do to control these debt cycles? I would have far more bank capital. I spent 4 years as the chair of the FSB's policy committee arguing as a hawk alongside, for instance, Philip Hildebrand, for higher capital requirements. And we were involved in rooms in Basel just along the road here with debates about were we going to increase it from 7 to 7.5, or was 8 too much, or was 8.5 a good figure? And I was always a hawk. And I think we've done a good job. I think we increased capital requirements in the banking system a lot. But I have to tell you simply that if I was the benevolent dictator designing a banking system for a greenfield economy, and I didn't have to worry with the problems of transition, I would have banks levered 5 to 1. I would have far more capital even than they have at the moment. I would have much stronger counter-cyclical levers. I would place limits on loan-to-value and loan-to-income limits to constrain borrowing. But I would also think about risk weights to reflect social risk, not private. Now, the bit that I'm clear about on this is that regulators should set the risk weight for lending against real estate at a higher level than it would ever appear rational for a private banker to set them. Under the Basel II, Basel III risk weighting, you can end up with an internal model convincing yourself that it is safe to give to a prime mortgage a risk weight as low as 10 or 15%. And actually, seen from a private point of view, that may truly reflect the probability of default of a prime mortgage. But the accumulation of huge numbers, even of prime mortgages, can do harm to the macroeconomy. Therefore, I think we made a fundamental intellectual mistake within the Basel II regime, which we have not changed in Basel III, of allowing risk weights, saying that risk rates should be entirely set on the basis of private assessments of the probability of default and the loss given of default. I would set the risk weights for real estate lending higher than the models suggest are required to deal with the probability of default, because I think there is an externality which is not captured by the probability of default. Now, the bit that I'm not sure of, but I simply put out there for debate, is once you accept that, should you ever also have lower risk weights for things that you believe not just higher risk weights for things where you think there's a negative externality, but lower risk weights for things where you think there is a positive externality? I'm not so sure of that. I mean, some people will look at this and say, okay, we should have lower risk weights for, I don't know, lending against green, you know, renewable energy. And I could construct an argument for that, because actually the single most important thing that changes the economics of renewable energy is the cost of capital up front. But I think I would say that if you want to do positive discrimination because there are positive externalities, that should probably be done by overt fiscal subsidies rather than asking that to be handed to something for the macroprudential regulator. I do, however, think that the macroprudential regulator should set higher risk weights for those areas of lending where there's a negative externality.
Thank you very much. Let's take three questions at a time, and if you could briefly tell us who you are. We got two mics, one over there. Antoinette, Matthias, and over here.
Hey, my name is Antoinette Hunziker. I'm the founder of Forma Futura. Yeah, why can't you become the successor of Mr. Draghi? But I have another question.
Well, we're not in the Eurozone. We're not even going to be in the European Union. Exactly. So I think it's a bit of a stretch.
A bit right now. Yes. How do you see the chances that we globally would implement a new way to measure the GDP, a way where the qualitative aspect of the GDP, the well-being, would also be encountered, where we internalize external costs, and who should be the we that this could be done in an effective way?
Okay, thank you. My name is Matthias Binswanger, professor of economics at the University of Applied Sciences of Northwestern Switzerland. Very long name, I know. And I agree with basically everything you said, maybe also because I've written a book which is called Money Out of Nothing, which basically says the same things. And what I want to say, maybe interesting that in Switzerland, the percentage of mortgage loans is even more than 90%. So we are probably the most extreme country of all of them. And the question is, I mean, what you suggest is something like a bit of a downsizing of this whole financial sector that has become too large relative to the real economy. But the problems I see here is that where should all the money actually go to that is existing today? Because I think there's not enough profitable investment opportunities in the real sector of the economy. And the second problem that I see, which goes back what you argued, that basically we have growth now by a lot of useless things or fashion, or we compete about things we don't really need, that I think, on the other hand, we need this because from production, more and more labor is disappearing. Yeah. So jobs are disappearing. Yeah. And where should all people work? So at the end, we are even happy we have a large financial sector where a lot of people work, even if they do not add anything useful to the economy.
Okay. Thank
you. Hello, thank you for your speech. My name is Michael McQuarty. I'm actually doing several things, but I'm a promoter of a new monetary policy instrument here in Switzerland, amongst other things. I have a question. I think you have basically two challenges. One of them you talked about is to get your economist peers out of their Harry Potter world and into the real world. The other challenge is obviously, if you want things to change, to also convince policymakers, possibly parliament and the entire population, that these changes are needed so they can be implemented. And so my question is, of these two challenges, which one you think is the most important one? Which one is the easiest one to achieve, and what kind of response you got so far? I'm probably sure you talked both to economists and policymakers.
Okay, fine. GDP measures. I'm a little bit wary of trying to say GDP is imperfect, so I'm going to get a perfect measure of welfare. I'm going to sort of create an algorithm where I bring in some other factors and whoosh, you know, that will be the thing I maximize. Because any of these other measures, and as you probably know, lots and lots of people have tried to have other measures, you know, ultimately have a somewhat arbitrary weighting algorithm where they say, I'm going to put this, you know, I'm going to put this thing on air quality or education on inequality versus GDP. And I think any of those exercises are attempting to reduce to a mechanical process something which is the very essence of political and social choice. I think we should escape from the idea that we have to maximize GDP growth. I think if you have a politician tell you this thing that you want to do, this environmental standard, I can't do it because my model tells me that my GDP growth will be you know, 1.7%, not 1.9%, you should have the willingness to say, so what? I'm not sure that the difference between 1.7 and 1.9 is all that powerful. But you should say, I think it's more important to have this environmental quality and 1.7 than 1.9 and not this. I'm not sure that that decision is helped by putting a cost on the environmental quality and trying to lock it into. So I am wary of the idea that we can define one mathematical defined maximand and, as it were, put public policy on a sort of autopilot. I think the very essence of political choice is to accept that there is no given maximand and that there should be an intelligent choice about the trade-offs and choices that we face. Downsizing the financial sector. Look, I am basically arguing that there, you know, we do have too big a financial sector. I think we've got too much debt. I think it would have been better if we had not created so much. You get interesting arguments. People say, well, how would people, you know, buy houses without, you know, all this debt? But actually, there's a very interesting process which has occurred in the UK where, beyond a point, more mortgage debt makes it more difficult for people to buy houses. That may seem extremely paradoxical, but what happens is, beyond a certain point, the easier the mortgage credit and the higher the loan to value, you drive the house prices to such a level that the new entrant to the housing market hasn't even got the deposit to afford to buy it, even with a very high LTV. From about the late 1990s onwards, UK owner occupation of houses began to fall, despite the fact that mortgage debt was going up and up and up, because the mortgage debt was being used by people who already had equity to bid up the prices more, or was being used by buy-to-let investors to accumulate portfolios of more and more houses, and was actually squeezing out. Now, this is incredibly difficult, just to flip on to the third question, to explain to policymakers. If you say to a policymaker, loan-to-value limits will be good for future first-time buyers of houses, it can't possibly be true, but actually you do have to think through that paradoxical effect because it can be true. But we are where we are. Now, some of you may know that there are very radical proposals out there. Some of you may know Michael Kumhoff, who's argued for a move to a 100% reserve banks, get rid of fractional reserve banks, get rid of all this debt. But to do that, he has to describe a transition process by which we get rid of all this debt. And what I've said to Michael, look, you've got something which has enormous winners and losers in it. You have to write off debt that already exists. I don't think there is any easy way to leap to a less leveraged economy. I think we have to slowly get to it over time. Now, part of how we need to get to it over time is we need to have other ways of stimulating nominal economic growth which do not depend on private debt creation. And I think I'll come back to that in a second. That is actually a fundamental part of my argument, my book. What are the two different ways to stimulate nominal income? And it has taken me down a very radical path. But before I turn to that, because I think it might be useful to come back to that because it's fundamental, let me just deal with the third question, and then I'm going to loop back to the two fundamental sources of nominal demand growth in an economy and the trade-off between debt and the devil, which is the core of my book. The third question was, what is the most difficult to change, policymakers or the academic economist community? I think I've got to say the latter, because I think they're almost impossible to change. I mean, I would say I and various other people have been really quite shocked at how difficult it has been to change the conventional wisdom of modern macroeconomics. And this point has been said again in an article which is circulating and getting a lot of attention by Paul Romer. Many of you may have seen this referred to, it's just come out, which is called, you know, What's Wrong with Macroeconomics? And, you know, he's saying things that I've said before. Willem Buiter has an absolutely wonderful quote, which I put at the top of the final chapter of my book, which simply says, it's in an article in 2009, which he entitled, "On the Unfortunate Uselessness of Most State-of-the-Art Academic Monetary Economics." And what he said then was, standard macroeconomic theory did not help foresee the crisis, nor has it helped understand it or craft solutions. Complete market macroeconomics theory not only did not allow the questions about insolvency and liquidity to be answered, they did not allow such questions to be asked. And Paul Romer has repeated this point, that a huge edifice of modern macroeconomics, which is highly mathematical, in order to be highly mathematical, has to start with such absurd assumptions about human behavior that, however elegant your mathematics, you're going to get nothing useful at the output. If you start a complicated piece of mathematical modeling with the statement, let me assume that the rational expectations hypothesis applies, and that human beings walk around the world, you know, developing their points of view of the future on the basis of rationally defined probability distributions of future results, then you are not going to produce sensible answers. But I think a lot of us thought that there would be far more radical change to economics in the face of the obvious failure of 2008. And I have been really quite shocked with the resilience of the system. And Paul Romer, in his latest article, you know, tries to say, well, why is that? And I think it has to do with the self-reinforcing nature of an academic discipline, the self-reinforcing nature of what peer-reviewed articles expect to see, the fact that each new generation of undergraduates and graduate students is brought up by a set of existing professors who, having learnt in a particular way, have an entire life invested in that way of thinking. So I think, and the Institute for New Economic Thinking was set up in 2009 precisely to try to challenge some of these ideas and produce new economic thinking. And I have to say, our job is about 10% done in terms of the way that we've managed to change the edifice of how a lot of economics is taught about. Though there is a lot of useful change going on. So I think it's easier to change that than, in some senses, than the policy environment. Though the policy environment is going through, I think, a really interesting development now. Over the last 6 months, and I was discussing this with Bill White earlier, I think the arguments that I've been making, and I make in this book, that ultra-loose monetary policy alone is not going to get us out of this debt trap, have suddenly shot up the agenda. There are different points of view as to what we should do to get out of the trap, but the world is now full of commentary to the effect that monetary policy alone is not going to do it and is not going to be effective. And I think, you know, that is, I think it's been delayed. I think it's later than it should have been. But I think there is an increasingly interesting ferment of ideas in public policy from which we will see some changes. Let me just...
Adair, before you want another round. Yeah, before you get to monetary finance, and I don't want us to lose, to leave this room without you talking about monetary financing. But let us get another two questions
Okay,
you got the answers, and then we'll go to the upper. We got one over here, and we got one over here.
Yeah, my name is Irmi Seidel. I'm environmental economist.
Right.
You said there are three reasons why we got into these problems: inequality, real estate, and global imbalances. But you didn't mention the reduction and the slowdown of the productivity rate. So there is arguments, there is a discussion that since the middle of the 70s, we have quite low productivity growth, and that's why we needed the credit growth to compensate this slowdown, to have some growth. This is the first thing. The second thing, you speak about 1% to 2% of growth. In Switzerland, we have 0.6 per capita. And in other European countries, that's similar. So I just want to stress that we are much below 1.5 or 1 point of growth. The third thing I want to mention, you said we have to change things in real estate, but real estate is strongly linked to old age insurance and pension funds. So if we want to have changes there, we have to think about the pension system and the old age insurance situation. So have you had thoughts on that?
Thank you, Irmi. Oliver Adler said he assumes you'll answer his question anyhow, so he will not ask it.
Okay, fine.
You go ahead.
Okay, on those questions, in the book, I primarily focus on giving an account of this debt overhang problem and hopefully exploring some of the deeper economic theory that lies behind it. And I'll come back to the whole monetization and money issue in a minute. In the book, I have about 2 pages on the secular stagnation hypothesis. If I was to rewrite the book now, I'd have a chapter on the secular stagnation hypothesis alongside the debt overhang hypothesis. I don't think they're competitive. I think they are, you know, complementary. I am, like most economists, increasingly interested in, alongside this clear problem created by too much debt, is there something secular and deep going on? Indeed, on Friday in DC, Larry Summers and I are sharing a platform at an INET event precisely to talk about secular stagnation and at a INET program where we're getting a whole load of economists to write papers on secular stagnation, and we'll have a conference next year entirely focused on it. Within the secular stagnation hypothesis, there's part of it which is about secular drivers of very low demand growth, and I think that's an important thing for us to explore. And essentially, I think we may face some secular drivers of low demand growth, which we managed to offset before the crisis, but only by an unsustainable rate of growth of debt. And I think, as it were, some of those secular trends were the reason why we ended up believing that we got to create all this credit, but then that thing came to an end. As for the productivity conundrum, I honestly don't know what I really believe about it. And I struggle with the following phenomenon. It goes back to the question somebody said earlier. On the one hand, I am convinced by writers like Erik Brynjolfsson and Andrew McAfee, in the book The Second Machine Age, that we are probably at the early stages and on the verge of a real you ain't seen nothing yet in automation and robotization. I think the pace at which information and communication technology is progressing means that we are going to be able to automate away all sorts of economic functions, creating some quite major issues about where do jobs come from, where does self-esteem come from, where does status come from in an environment where, bluntly, we will be able to produce all the manufactured goods that the world needs, probably with about 3% of the global workforce, would be my guess. So on the one hand, I've got that. On the other hand, like everybody else, I'm staring at these slow rates of productivity growth actually measured. And I'll bluntly say, I'm going to spend more time thinking about it. I didn't talk about it because I don't know what the answer is, because I'm still struggling with the conundrum. I do think I understand why there are some secular drivers of deficient demand. I'm not quite sure how I think about the supply side story of secular stagnation. On real estate and pensions, the only thing I want to say on pensions is, and I was for 3 years chairman of the UK Pension Commission, which produced some quite radical proposals which were enacted to our pension system. Those included many things, but they in particular involved an increase in the standard state pensionable age in the UK from 65 to 68 over a few decades. And the point I simply want to make is that if we try to deal with rising longevity, which is not a problem, it's the most wonderful thing imaginable that we've got more years of life. If we try to deal with rising longevity by continuing to retire at the same age, but then trying to work out how we pile up enough assets to live throughout that longer, ever longer period of old age with an ever higher percentage of total adult life spent in retirement, we will be attempting to do something which is unachievable either in the private sense or the public sense. All pension systems, whether they be funded pay-as-you-go or whether they be unfunded pay-as-you-go, or whether they be funded through capital market accumulation, will only be sustainable if we try to keep roughly stable the proportions of adult life spent working and in retirement. And quite a lot of the problems of pension systems disappear if you make that one simple change. Let me end with, what on earth are we going to do to escape from the debt overhang? Ultra-loose monetary policy, after a while, is ineffective. Once you go negative, it may actually be adverse. If it did work, it would only work by reigniting private credit growth. Fiscal policy could stimulate the economy, and by the way, we could choose to skew fiscal policy towards specific sustainable ends to deal with problems like climate change, etc. As I said, I'd rather do that through fiscal policy than by asking the financial regulator to take responsibility for that. But that appears blocked by public debt sustainability concerns. And this is where you get the problem where we're out of ammunition. We can't do anything. I want to be absolutely clear. If our problem is a deficiency of spending power, of nominal demand, there is always a solution. It's quite a radical solution. It's quite a controversial solution, but it is always available. And it is called helicopter money. It is called overt monetary finance of fiscal deficits. And it is the one thing which will always increase spending power and nominal demand. Now, the moment you say that, people think, oh, Adair's gone mad now. He's sort of just, you know, we always were a bit worried about him, but he's gone completely unorthodox, et cetera, et cetera. The only trouble is, if I have gone, you know, off the reservation at this level and turned into a sort of mad, inflation-loving socialist, I'm in pretty good company. Because here's what Milton Friedman says, and here's what Henry Simons says, and here's what Ben Bernanke said. Henry Simons was one of the founding fathers of the Chicago School of Economics. He hated inflation. He really hankered after zero or negative inflation, but he accepted that you probably wanted a small positive rate of inflation. And he ended up believing that the best way to control the price level should be to expand and contract issues of actual money, by which he meant sovereign money created by the state. And he said monetary rules should be implemented and in turn largely determine fiscal policy. He didn't believe in a complete separation of fiscal and monetary policy. He said the two should be coordinated. Milton Friedman in 1948 was even more explicit. Milton Friedman in 1948, in a document entitled A Framework for Financial and Monetary Stability, he said, why are we bothering to try to manage the macroeconomy through this incredibly complicated mishmash of central banks and commercial banks and open market operations and interest rates? He said, if you want to grow nominal GDP by 3 or 4% per annum, the money stock will have to grow by 3 or 4% per annum. And the obvious way to do that is to run a small fiscal deficit each year, which is entirely financed by the central bank creating money and giving it to the fiscal authority to spend. So he said government expenditures would be financed exclusively by either tax revenues or, to the extent there was a deficit, by the creation of money. The chief function of the monetary authority should be the creation of money to meet government deficits and also the retirement of money if you wanted to run a surplus. But basically, governments should run money-financed surplus deficits or money withdrawing surpluses, but any idea of the separation of fiscal and monetary policy he rejected in that article. Ben Bernanke, telling the Japanese what to do in 2003, said, "You are stuck in an environment where monetary policy simply won't work. What you ought to do is a tax cut for households and businesses that is explicitly coupled with incremental BOJ purchases of government debt so that the tax cut is in effect financed by money creation, with it clear that much or all of the increase in the money stock is viewed as permanent." These are all arguments that there exist circumstances in which we should have monetization. And I have argued at the IMF last year in a, I don't know quite why this is on a, why we're on a band here, it's just it's happened, in a paper which I entitled "The Case for Monetary Finance, an Essentially Political Issue," that what you have to understand about monetary finance is that there's one argument against it and only one argument against it. And you've got to decide how important that argument is. If anybody tells you that there's something about monetary finance, that it has within it some mathematical knife edge, where the moment you start doing it, it's bound to produce hyperinflation, they're wrong. If you do a small amount of it, it'll have a small stimulative effect. If you do a massive amount, it'll produce hyperinflation. There is a function that relates the impact on nominal demand to how much you do. It may well have an accelerating curve over time, but there is no reason to believe that it has a kink in it where there's some knife edge discontinuity and you suddenly leap to hyperinflation. And nobody has specified that. It depends on the amount you do. If somebody tells you that once you start doing monetary finance, the central bank is committed forever to maintain zero interest rates, that is definitively and absolutely technically wrong, and they have not done their homework and they have not worked it through. It's not true. You can do monetary finance, you can make sure that the money you create is permanently non-interest bearing, but you can keep that as a bit of the monetary base, which is held in non-interest bearing reserves at the central bank, even while the central bank moves the policy rate on reserves at the margin to a non-zero positive level. If anybody tells you that by doing that, you are imposing a tax on future bank credit intermediation, the answer is you are absolutely right, and that's a damn good thing to do. What we want to do is to stimulate the economy today to get out of the mess that we're in because of over large private credit creation, while creating a drag anchor on future excessive credit creation. So what's not to like about something which stimulates the economy today, but which in order to constrain for the future involves imposing a tax on future bank credit intermediations? So all the technical arguments are wrong. I've got very aggressive about this now. You know, I've set it out, and the reason why I'm confident is I keep on setting them out. People keep on suggesting there's a technical argument against, you know, and then I say, no, that's not true for these reasons. And at the moment, I'm not facing a single technical argument that I feel at all convincing. And if you want to go through the debates on this and the INET blog, there's a blog by me which has an answer to all the technical arguments that are put forward. They're wrong. Essentially, technically, you can do monetary finance and the impact will depend on how much you do. The only argument against monetary finance, but it's a very important one, is the political argument. It's a moral hazard argument that once you accept that it is possible to do monetary finance, once you tell politicians that this isn't some impossible thing, once you break the taboo, will be inevitably be tempted to do too much. That argument, I respect. I don't agree that that should be a knockout, but I respect it because it is a coherent, well-specified argument rooted in the fact that there is empirical history, much empirical history, of us overdoing it. The question then becomes, can we design institutional mechanisms whereby we trust ourselves to use monetary finance while not overdoing it? I believe we can, and Ben Bernanke believes we can. Ben, in a Brookings Institute blog in April, said, why can we not give to a central bank the authority to determine how much monetary finance is appropriate in order to hit the inflation target, while leaving the fiscal authority responsible to decide how that money is spent? I think that is possible. I think that is part of central bank independence. I do not understand why, if we can give away from politicians to central bankers the interest rate tool and trust that politicians will not immediately demand it back, which is the great trick of central bank independence, I don't see why we couldn't do the same in deciding the quantity of central bank monetary creation, permanent monetary creation. But I end with this point, that if you don't want to do that, you've got to go back to the fundamentals of where does nominal demand growth come from. And I ended up believing you write a book, and it's only when you've written a book, and indeed it's sometime after the book, that you end up knowing what the central argument, or the central, you know, somewhat new argument, distinctive argument that you're making is. And mine is this. I think there are essentially two, and essentially only two, sources of nominal demand growth. I think we will only get economies which grow nominal GDP if one of two things is happening. One is if there is sovereign fiat money creation now or expected in the future, and actually occurring in the future, i.e. if the government funds fiscal deficits now with money, or if when it funds them with debt, there is an expectation that some of that might be monetized in the future, you will get a growth in nominal demand. Or if you have private credit and money creation. That's what I'm asserting, and I think not many people have asserted that that is the essence of money creation, but I'm confident now that it is the case. And what I find really interesting is that in relation to those two ways of creating nominal demand, two different schools of thought have had diametrically opposed points of view. The modern orthodoxy, the pre-crisis orthodoxy, is set out on the top here. It is that fiat money creation, governments running deficits and funding them with money, is so unbelievably dangerous that it should be completely forbidden. Central banks must never monetize government debt. While before the crisis, we believed that free markets and the banking system creating credit and money, because disciplined by rational agents operating in a competitive market, was bound to produce a perfect result, so that whatever amount of debt and money there was by definition the optimal amount of debt and money. So that way around, fiat money creation is the work of the devil. Private credit and money creation is the work of rational angels. What is interesting is that a group of very intelligent economists in the 1930s believed absolutely the diametric opposite of that. Henry Simons and Irving Fisher and the other people who sent the Chicago Plan to Franklin Delano Roosevelt in 1935 argued for 100% reserve banking. They said that fractional reserve banks were so dangerous that they absolutely must be abolished. Henry Simons wrote, and this is a man who believed completely free markets in every other area of the economy. He wrote, private initiative has been allowed too much freedom in determining the character of our financial structure and in directing changes in the quantity of money and money substitutes. In the very nature of the system, banks will flood the money with money substitutes during booms and precipitate futile efforts at general liquidation thereafter. He believed that we had made a category error in believing that banks were like other companies and that their activity was like producing cars or producing restaurant meals. He believed that creating money was an essentially sovereign activity and we shouldn't allow the private sector at all to do it. So that's why they argued for the complete abolition of fractional reserve banks and the creation of a system in which the only money would be monetary base. There would be no difference between the money supply and the monetary base. All money would be sovereign money. But the moment they accepted that, and this is also in the 1948 Friedman article, you logically have to accept that you're only going to get nominal demand growth if you create some new sovereign money every year, if you have some small fiscal deficits entirely financed with money. You've got to choose. You've got to choose whether you're going to have the private sector create more money and purchasing power or the public sector create more money and purchasing power. It's got to come from somewhere. Now, you believe the top if you believe that states and political processes fail because of short-term politics, and if you believe that markets are inherently efficient and rational. You believe the bottom if you believe that bank credit markets are inherently inefficient and stable, and that political processes are capable of being rational. I believe that political processes are just about capable of being rational if we very carefully design our institutional rules and responsibilities. And I believe that markets are far from efficient and rational, but that we can make them somewhat more efficient and rational by tight rules and controls on them. I therefore think that we should not either iconize the market and demonize the state, and that's why I ended up with this title, Between Debt and the Devil. I think we were wrong to trust private credit creation as much as we did before the crisis. I think we're wrong to exclude sovereign money creation as one of our ways out of the crisis, but I think there are no panaceas because the failure of both political processes and markets are both rooted in the same thing, which is the fact that human beings are only partly rational and that the future is not governed by a given probability distribution, but by inherent radical uncertainty. And that's why I think we're stuck between debt and the devil. Thanks.
Adair, thanks so much for what I think was a very inspiring and to some extent for many of us also radical speech, both on the questions that we should ask, but also the answers that we should explore and also the scope of the debate, how we should expand that. Let me just finish with a couple of a few points first. We have a couple of copies of the book outside for you, not for everybody, to create a bit of a run maybe. So there are some books outside. Second, I wanted to mention that several of you will probably know that this concept of sovereign money is up for a popular vote in Switzerland. And if you are interested in talking to two persons who are in the committee driving this, we got Mr. Haringer and Ms. Schmid in the back who are involved in the Vollgeld Initiative here. And finally, I would just ask you to join me again in a big round of applause for our speaker tonight, Adair Turner.